Okay, I do want to say a little bit about the bonuses. End of the semester, when final grades are posted and you have a 68 or 78 or an 88, and you email me saying, what can I do? I'm just 2 points away from passing, or 2 points away from a C, or 2 points away from a B. What can I do? I will say, the bonuses that I told you you could do all semester is what you could have done, okay? So I'm not, last semester I kind of had a little bit of an issue and I wound up curving some of my scores in Cal 2. I don't normally do that. I can promise you here, it's not happening. No curves. It's just your grade is your grade. So these are the chances that you're getting to boost your grade up. How much these are worth, I can't tell you right now, but they're at least 1 point in your overall grade, at least 1 point. So if I give, you know, 5, 6, 7 of these, you could adjust your grade by almost half a letter grade if you just take the time to do these bonus problems. All right? Each one is worth 1 point overall. 1 point. It's worth it, okay? All right, but that's it. Once they're due, they're due. Yeah, okay. Yeah, and you have to keep in mind also, I mean, they are bonus, you know, so I expect good, you know, a good solid, you know, you've had time to think about it and put it down on paper and translate it over to me. Anyone else want to turn in their signed, I understand the grading scheme, syllabus and all that? Okay. All right, we have a lot to cover. Let me shut this door because it kind of bothers me to have it open. All right, a couple of order of business here. I sent out an email with your first mini exam, which is your first take-home exam. It's due on the 5th of February. And so I just made copies for everyone. I think there were some problems printing it. I think there will be some more coming around. If you have extras, just pass them this way. So did anybody take the time to download that CDF player? Anybody? Did you have a problem with the download? Okay, did anybody download the CDF player and successfully open the file I sent? Yes? And you're able to manipulate and like, okay, so it can be done. That's all I want to make sure is it can be done as I expect it to. My advice is that if you download the CDF player to your computer, then download the file I send to your computer. Download it, save it to your computer, then open the CDF player. Go to File, Open, then go grab the document you saved and open it. If you try and open the document from its location, it may have a problem. I would highly recommend that you download that CDF player so you can visualize this stuff at home, because it will help you. I mean, maybe not on this mini exam, but like, you know, one of the next 8 to 10 that I'm going to give you, I'll give you some object and to be able to rotate it and look at what I'm asking for will really help you. If you're just going off a static picture on a page, it might be a challenge. So I would hope you would do that. If you ever want to come by my office, I can sit down and, you know, show you on my computer if you don't want to go download it. And I just want you to use the technology. It's there, you know, so let's try and use it. What else? The notes. Last week I provided the first two sets of lecture notes, right? I said the rest are on the web, you know, you want to print them out. I went ahead and brought the next set. But how many of you actually brought the next set yourself? Just curious. It's a lot of paper, right? So I'm going to try and keep bringing them, Okay, I'm going to try to keep bringing them. They've never told me anything about using too much paper, so I don't really care about it. But I'm going to try to keep bringing them, but it keeps on printing it in this weird format, so we'll just have to live with it. It's backwards. Now, homework. Pardon? We're going to finish 10-2, but there's 10-3 for you. As far as the homework is concerned, I don't know how many of you noticed that in Canvas, I actually posted the solutions to the homework. Yeah, they just kind of pop in there whenever I get to it. I forget what day I did them. I think it was Friday or something. So here are the solutions to the first homework assignment. It's all color-coded and everything, and I really took my time with it. I haven't taught Cal 2 or Cal 3 in 2 years, so this is my opportunity to go and do all the homework again. So that's what I'm doing. So every time I finish it, I'll post it. I won't send an announcement, I'll just post it. And then I work through on the next section. Wait a minute, is this everything? That's number three. Oh, wait, that's 10-2. Here's 10-1. So there's all my nice 3D stuff and my pictures. This hopefully will help you, me showing you how I did it might help you in your drawing in 3D. This first assignment was kind of forcing you to start to draw in 3D, which is a bit of a challenge. All right. So were there any questions over the homework? Now, because the solutions are up there, I'm going to be real picky about what I answer. So anything that really kind of threw you? Which one? Ten two, number two. Wait, number two? Did I assign number two in 10-2? Did I not do it here? Is this it right here? Okay, I accidentally put three. Oops. That's two, though. Well, not to blow off your question, but I think what I have here is enough. If you go home and look, I think you'll be able to make sense out of this now. Just the biggest thing is that when you subtract a vector, all it does is changes its direction. So if you go, I'll just point it out right here. If you subtract the vector AB, so this is the vector AB, it goes from A to B. If you subtract that vector, it becomes the vector that goes from B to A instead. So that's why minus AB becomes plus BA. That's one thing you kind of have to take account for. Is that okay? Anything else? Same section? Three vectors, you just go tip to tail to tip to tail. Yeah, it doesn't have to make a triangle. No. Like this one is VU, VUW. First you do V, then you do U, then you do W. The result is the vector that goes from here to here. So your answer is the black right here. Is that kind of okay? All right. Remember, the expectation today is that you would have at least attempted all this homework, right? Yes. Yes. Y is less than 8. Yeah, it's weird. I mean, the book, the solutions in the back of the book, they call it a half space, right? But it's, oh, that one's not. Yeah, that one should be in there in the book, right? Everyone okay with what the plane y equals 8 looks like? Y equals 8. So this is y equals 8 right here. And then what you want is all your y values to be less than that. So that'd be everything towards the origin, I guess you could say. So it's everything that direction, but up forever, down forever, this way, that way, it, you know, infinite solid, except that at 8, because it's a strictly less than, the plane itself is not included. So it's almost like you used to have parentheses for leaving open circles and then brackets for open for solid dots. This would be the plane itself isn't included in your solid. Everything to the left, I guess we could say, yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I mean, it's tough to say this. It's tough, I mean, because you could say it so many different ways and it still makes sense. I think the part of it that's most important is the visual part of it. Can you visualize what y less than 8 looks like? Parallel to XZ, yes, uh-huh. It's a solid, but when you say solid parallel to it, you could say that this face of it is parallel because there really is no top or side or bottom because it keeps going. So it's tough to say parallel unless you orient like the solid, what part of the solid's parallel? That face is parallel. Sure. That's why the book says half space. Because you've got the solid that takes up half of your three-dimensional space, and then the other half is not included. Although half is kind of weird because it goes infinitely in both directions. So what's half, you know? All right, well, let's get going here. We have to resume where we were last time, right? I also, just so you know, I posted this 3D graph paper online that if you want to, you can print out a couple of pages, and it might help you to see. Is that all right? Let me just show you how you'd plot something here using this graph paper. I'm trying a new program today. Well, actually, it's not right here. When we get to Mathematica, it will be, but if my computer crashes, I'm expecting it could possibly happen. Just be aware. Let's say I wanted to plot the point 4, 2, 5. Plot that point. Using this graph paper, x positive, y positive, z positive, you go out 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 on the x-axis, right? 2 on the y would come towards us, right? So 1, 2. And then your z is straight up 5, right? See how I did that? 4, and then over 2, and then up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that would put me right there. Oh, did I go up too high? Okay, thank you. That's the point right there. You see? So I went over, and up like that to get to that point. What's 3? I went up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 units. Oh, I see what you're doing. You're saying 3 from there. Okay, yeah, that's not what it is because, look, if I go up 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 right there, imagine coming straight across. Let me see. I'm trying to figure out where I would hit this. They would hit like this in this corner, like that. Do you see that? Does that help or no? No? Are you being sarcastic? Okay. Watch, if I come over to here, I could come over to it also like this. And if I connect this corner straight down, you see that? Does that help at all or no? Yeah, well, the regular throws you way off because everything, nothing's parallel. This graph paper is special because what it does is it keeps every line that, you know, should, every x value, right? I come out x. When I move over, if I draw back to x, it should be parallel to that x-axis. So this graph paper keeps all your lines parallel to the axes. Got lines parallel to the x-axis, got lines parallel to the y-axis, got lines parallel to the z-axis. It's just, I just want you to know it's there if you want to mess with it. I'm not going to ask that you become proficient with three-dimensional graphing here, but if, you know, if you're not going to be doing this, practicing it, then you should download that player so that you can visualize this stuff. I can't remember. I don't think on this test, but you know, you should always, if you have an issue, come talk to me about it. Like if you're unsure about something. All right, let's get going. All right, so we left off last time, right here. Right, we were talking about vectors last time. And now we wanted to talk about the lengths of vectors, okay? Before I get too far, I want to make sure I'm recording here. I am, and I've got audio. Okay, so here's my new program. Let's see if I cause problems here. I should be able to draw within Mathematica. And then right-click to get out of it and be back in Mathematica. And then should be able to clear. Okay, let's hopefully that'll stay stable the whole class. Okay, so length of a vector is pretty much what you would expect because it's based on the Pythagorean identity. All it's saying is, look, you've got a vector, right? Vector has a tail and a tip. You want to know how long it is. So all you have to do is come in here and throw down a right triangle like this. And remember that V1 was the x component of the vector and V2 was the y component of the vector. Therefore, by the Pythagorean identity, a squared plus b squared is c squared. So that length should be the square root right here. Of V1 squared plus V2 squared. Now the notation we use is an absolute value around the V, around the vector V. That's also called the norm. It's the norm of the vector, the length. And then if you go to three-dimensional space, the formula is exactly the same with one additional thing, which is what? You have that third component, so you throw it in there. Pretty straightforward. All right, here we go. So what I want us to do with this first one is let's find and sketch V minus U, then U minus V, then negative 2U, and then V minus 2U. So I give you two vectors and ask you to go ahead and sketch those. Now that's those vectors, V and U, live in what space? 2D, right? 2D. The next example, we live in 3D. But notice in example 4, I don't ask you to sketch. I just ask you to compute. So I don't think I want to take a whole bunch of time to do all A, B, C, and D. So you pick. I'll do two of them. Which one do you want? Which two would you like me to do? A, B, C, D. B and D? Okay, let me do B and D. Okay, I'm going to try to first draw my axes over here. And let's draw V and U separately. So V is the vector 2, 3. So I go to the right 2, up 3. Change my color here. Right there. That is my vector V. U is negative 1, negative 4. Negative 1, negative 4. That's you. So I want to now find V minus U. So that means I want to attach the tip of V, the tip of V to the tail of what? Negative U, right? Negative U. So in other words, I'm saying I'm going to take V here. I'm going to add negative U, like that. Oh, wait, am I doing A? Damn it. I'm doing A, everyone. Sorry. That's why you're squinting your eyes. Okay, I'm doing A instead of B. B would be the same thing, but backwards, right? I go U plus negative B. Do you want to draw a negative U? What would negative U be? Yeah, negative U is the vector -1, -4. So I'm just scaling it, which makes it a +1, +4. So if I were to graph that, it would be here. That right there is negative U. So let's go ahead and attach. I'm going to take the purple one, right? The purplish light purple, and I'm going to attach the tail of it to the tip of the V vector, which is like that dark red. So it should be somewhere around, let me see, it'll go right one, two, three, four, somewhere around there. Jeez, I can't draw a straight line for my life right now. Yeah, that was negative U right there. This was my V right there. So the result, the end result is the vector that goes from the origin all the way to the tip up there. Is that good enough? Does that make sense? Any questions? So that's the sketch of it, right? But what is V minus U? What is it? So I'm going to do this computation, right? I think I'll switch over here. Can I get off this page? Okay. Oh, no, I can't. So right now I want to do V minus U over here. What was the V vector? Grab my notes. I'm going to pass the sign-in sheet around. Here you go. Thanks. Just set it right there. What was it? 2, 3, right? So we're taking 2, 3, and we are subtracting from it the vector -1, -4, -4. This is going to be the same as 2, 3 plus the vector 1, 4. So I distribute that negative sign through. And how do you add vectors? Add components, right? So this is 3, 7. With me? That is V minus U. Now, I'm not going to draw the next one, but on part D, I ask you to find V minus 2U. So without doing the sketch, all this would be is V, which is 2, -3, minus 2 times U, which is -1, -4. I can distribute the negative 2 through. Did I make that a negative? No, that's right. What's going on? Is it 2, 3? And I don't know why y'all didn't say anything earlier. Okay. Yeah, I didn't. This will become 2-8, right? And then add together component, right? You add the twos together, you get 4. Add the y components, you get 11. Now, what I haven't asked you for, which I think I'm going to ask you for now, is what's the length of this? So this is not in our example here, but I'm going to ask you right here for you to find the magnitude of V minus 2U. Right. So we already know what this is, right? That right there in highlight in yellow, that's U minus 2, V minus 2U, right? So the magnitude of that is just the square root of, and we're treating the 4 like the V1, and we're treating the 11 like the V2 in the formula. So it's V1 squared plus V2 squared, right? Square root. 137, and that's it, square root of 137. So the length of that vector is the square root of 137. Nope, leave it, yeah. Even if it was like, well, if it was square root of 9, of course, it turns to 3. But if it was the square root of like 18, I don't care if you go 3 root 2. I don't care. You can leave it as root 18. It's 137 prime. Yeah, I think it is. What were you saying? Is there anything you can do to it? Yeah, I don't think you can. There's nothing anyway. Okay. Is there a 4 going? No. All right, let's go back to the notes here. I'm going to clear out this picture, maybe. Clear that out. I'm going to switch back here. What I'd like to do here on this one is only the last one here. Okay? I'd like for us to do part D. 4V minus 3U magnitude. All right? That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do it all on this page. Here we go. So I want you to try and pay attention to my notation. In other words, the way I write everything. I have, this is equal to the magnitude of 4 times, what's the vector V? 2, 3, negative 5, and then minus 3 times the vector u, which is negative 5, 7, negative 2. What else do I need here? Magnitude, so close out the absolute value. So I'm going to do the absolute value of that, which equals, now I'm going to go absolute value, I'm going to distribute the 4 through 8, 12, negative 20, and then I'm going to distribute the negative through, negative 3, which is going to keep it now as a positive, plus. And then we'll have 15, negative 21, 6. Close out the absolute value. Now add them component-wise. We have a new vector. It's 23. Where do we have it? Negative. Right? 9, okay, and then negative 14. Everyone agree with that? Everyone agree? And now you might want a calculator, because now we need the magnitude. So the magnitude, if we're treating each of these components, you know, V1, V2, V3, then the formula is just square root 23 squared plus negative 9 squared is 81 plus negative 14 squared won't matter because it's going to turn positive, right? So my calculator died. Its batteries are dead, so someone else can get that for me. Total, 529 for the first one, and then plus 81, and plus 196. Add all those up for me, please. What is it? 806. Like I said, I'm not too concerned about breaking that down. Yeah, we may need a decimal at some point, so as long as. Yes. What do you mean? Yes. Yeah, the absolute value of a vector is not just all the components turned positive. It's the length of the vector. It's two different things. So you can't, I think my interpretation of your question is take the absolute value and change those to positive. Is that what you're saying? It will be the same, but are you saying take this and get rid of these? Okay. The length of this vector will be the same as the length of this without negatives, but I would not change those because technically this vector is completely different as far as its direction than the one where this is positive and positive. So just leave it and then just go here. And once you square them, it won't matter. But okay, to me, this is pretty straightforward stuff. I mean, you have formula, plug and chug, grind it out. There's no magic here, right? We'll get to the magic, don't worry. All right. So now, we talk about unit vectors. So any vector, right? We have the idea of a vector out there. Any vector that its length is 1. So when you take the square root of the sum of the components squared, that number is 1, that's called a unit vector. So what I've done here in this example is I have the blue is a vector. It's the vector V. You see it right here, 1.943. So I go out 1.94. I go up 3. That's my blue vector. Notice that no matter where, there we go. I do it that way. No matter where I make this blue vector, there's always a red one pointed in the same direction that has a length of 1. So no matter what vector I ever have, except the 0 vector, there's always some red one pointed in the same direction with length 1. What if my blue vector is down here? It's smaller than 1, my blue one. Well, there's still a vector pointed in the same direction that has a unit length, length of 1. With me? The question is, right? How do you find that vector? So if I give you the blue vector, can you tell me what the red one is? And here's the formula for it. So given any vector in R2 or R3, a unit vector pointed in the same direction as you can be found by computing the following: u divided by its own magnitude. That's the formula for it. It's that vector, that blue vector, whatever it is, u, divide it by its own magnitude. Now, what is 1 over u here? I think I pointed out here to you also. What is, come on, you can do it. What is 1 over u? 1 over the magnitude of u. Well, u doesn't have to be a unit vector. U is just any vector. But is that Is that a vector? Is 1 over the magnitude of a vector, or is it a number? What's the magnitude of a vector? It's its length, right? Which is a number. What's 1 divided by a number? A number, right? Agreed? So what I've circled there is a number. What's a number times a vector? A scalar multiple, isn't it? So isn't this just a scalar multiple of u? It's actually scaling it by how much? 1 over its own length, right? So it's like taking a vector and scaling it, which, remember, scaling makes it longer or shorter, but you scale it by its own length, and that means it automatically reduces it to have a length of 1. That's all it is. Now, there's an even more powerful way of doing it. Well, I won't do it. I won't do it. Here's what I'd like for you to do, if you'd like a bonus question, is to show that this will always have unit length. Show me with the computation in R2 and in R3 that if you do this computation, you're guaranteed to have 1 as your answer for the length of this vector. So I'm saying the length of 1 over the magnitude of u times u, show that it's equal to 1 in R2 and in R3. So you have to start out with the general vector. Okay, start out with u is equal to whatever, a vector. Don't give me a specific example, a general vector, and show me that when you take the magnitude of that, it's always 1. All right. We're going to take it on faith here that it works, and we're just going to move to the next example. I think there's an example now. Yeah. So here we go. We've got a vector in R3, right? And I'd like for us to now find a unit vector that points in the same direction as V. So the first thing I'm going to do is find its length. How long is V? Because I need that in that formula, don't I? So what is this first? Well, that's square root of the sum of the square of the components. That's just the length. So what's that, 36? Which is 6. That's how long V is. The formula to find a unit vector pointed in the same direction as this vector is to compute 1 over magnitude, is it 38? I'm not paying attention. I should pay more attention in class. Where do we get 36 from? I don't know. I think I looked at it and said the same thing in my head, too. All right, so I'm trying to do 1 over the magnitude of V, what's next? Times V, right? Times V. So this means 1 divided by the magnitude of V times what? V, what's V? It's the vector to 3, negative 5. Do you all see that? That's 1 over its length times the vector itself. Now, how do we multiply a scalar times a vector? Just like distribute it through. It's each component gets scaled. So I get a new vector. It's 2 over root 38. 3 over root 38, negative 5 over root 38. Now, does everyone see? It's pretty important for you to notice that this right here in red is just a number times our vector. So what did we say? Two vectors are said to be what if they're scalar multiples of each other? Parallel. Good. So these vectors are actually parallel. They're pointed in the same direction, right? When I take 1 over root 38, multiply times that vector, I get a new vector. It's pointed in the same direction. How do I know it's not pointed in the opposite direction? It's a positive number, right? If it was negative, that would point it in the other direction. So it's pointing in the same direction. It's making it smaller, right? In this case, it's smaller. How do I know that that's a unit vector, though? Find the magnitude of this vector. See, now, if you wanted to check, this should be a vector that's pointed in the same direction as V up there, but it should be have a length of 1. So let me check it real quick. To check it, let me find the magnitude of this vector. And the answer should be what? 1? Find the magnitude. Isn't that just the square root of the sum of each of the components squared? All right, square the first one. What happens when you square 2 over root 38? 4 over 38, sorry. Plus square 3 over that, you get 9 over 38. And then if you square the last one, 25 over 38. And if you add those fractions together, you get 38 over 38. That's 1 over 1. Square root of 1 is 1. So the length of that vector is 1. And it's pointed in the same direction because it's a scalar multiple. So any questions? The way I did that is pretty much the way you would lay out the bonus. But you can't use specific numbers. Everyone should be able to get that bonus, I think. We'll see. At least make a good attempt at it. Next thing. All right, for those people who have taken linear algebra, standard basis vectors, or physics, we have two very important vectors in two-dimensional space, which are called the standard basis vectors. We call them I hat and J hat. Right here, I hat, J hat. It's like a bolded I with a little pointy on top of it, like a cap. And then the J is the same thing. They are the vectors 1, 0, and 0, 1. Have y'all seen those before? Any of my linear algebra people want to tell me what is a standard basis vector? It's an orthogonal basis, which means that not only are these vectors not only do they span all of R2, I'm speaking to the linear algebra people, not only do they span R2, they're orthogonal. And that's why they're the ones we use, actually in their normals, they're unit one, the orthonormal basis too. So it's like the best basis you can get for R2, I and J. Now, those vectors, what do they look like? We're going to see them down here. We're going to try and see them down here. Here we go. Here's I and J. So I is the vector 1, 0. That means you just go to the right one, and that's it. And then J hat is the one that goes straight up. The reason why they're so important is that any vector in R2, any vector, can be, you can create any vector in R2 by just taking linear combinations of those two vectors. So this drawing shows it. And I think I'll move the vector to the other side first. Take that vector U, okay? How can I recreate U using just the greens? Well, I take that one, right, and I multiply, I scale it to make it longer to make it this red one. And then I take the J and I scale it to make it longer to make it this red one straight up and down. And then I add those two vectors together, and won't I be there? Taking the two red ones, tail to tip, tip to tail, you'll be at the end of the black one. That can be done for any vector in R2. You can always find some way to combine I and J together and get that vector. And the same can be said for R3. So back, I haven't done R3, sorry. In R3, you have the same thing. You have standard basis vectors. The three vectors now are I, J, and K, So you've introduced K, and notice how I has changed. What's I? 100 instead of 10, because now you're in three space, so you need a third component. So you have 100, J is 010, and K is 001. And the idea here, again, is that no matter what vector you draw in three-dimensional space, you can get to it by combining those three vectors together. It'd be a little harder to draw, but you could do it. So just be aware of the standard basis vectors in R2 and R3. In this example, all I want you to do is write this vector as a linear combination of standard basis vectors. So what space do we live in here? Three-dimensional space. So what are the standard basis vectors in three-dimensional space? I, J, and K are my vectors. And I would like to write this as a combination of those. So check this out. I start out by, let me write the vector. And tell me if you agree with this. Is this not the same as isn't that those three vectors added together? Right? Add those three, and you would get the one on the left. And you may sit there and be saying, hey, you're making it more complicated than it is. That's not the point. The point is that can you rewrite any vector as a linear combination, or that means a sum, basically, of those three vectors? Now, 200 is not I, is it? But if I factor a 2 out, and what could I factor out of the next one? 3. And the last one, I'll put negative 5 out in front like this. Now, 100, 010, and 001 are my three basis vectors, aren't they? I, J, and K. So I could just write instead 2i. Right, 2i hat plus 3j hat minus 5k hat. It's just an exercise in sums and multiplication and scaling. It's nothing too crazy there. Geometrically, though, think about what it's saying. Okay, try and understand this geometrically. We're saying if you take the vector 100, which in 3D points out the x-axis 1, right? Here's my x, here's my y, and z is up this way. If I take this vector and multiply it by how much? 2, so now I'm out here. Then add to it the vector that goes out that way, 1 unit, but scale that by 3. So put that one next to this one, and then take negative 5 times the one that points up. So that makes you point down 5. Add it to the end of that, and that'll take you to the same place that this is. But it's a combination of the three I, J, and K vectors. All right, we're moving on. Is that the end? Okay. I was like, why is there not anything else? All right. Before I move to the next section, real quick, this might help you out a little bit on an assignment here. When you have an object, let's say like an airplane, Here's my airplane, and I'm actually, it doesn't really look like an airplane there. Okay, and this is like a top view of my airplane traveling. Then you can always consider your airplane as being a point, and then the direction it's traveling, so it's traveling in this direction like this, that arrow is being a vector. The longer the vector is, the faster it's going. The shorter the vector is, the slower it's going, right? Then let's say you have some sort of crosswind, let's say. Say wind is blowing like this, okay? What's the effect on that plane? Well, that would be the same as taking a vector on that point. Whatever the wind is, the stronger the wind, the longer the vector, the shorter, the less, right? And then the result would be that the plane's aiming one direction, but the wind is pushing in another direction. The result is the parallelogram law. So the resultant vector would be tail to tip, would be the same as that airplane pointing in that direction. So this would be a slight tailwind almost, right? So even though the plane's aiming that way, the wind's coming across, right? The result is that black vector. So it's actually going faster than what the throttle's set at because the wind is helping it a little bit. Does that make sense? One of your mini exam questions is related to that. So lengths of vectors are the speeds. So it's like the magnitude is the speed. The magnitude of the vector is the speed. The way it appears here on the mini test, a plane is aimed southeast, has throttle set at 400 miles per hour. There is a 25 mile hour crosswind blowing in the west direction. A person on the plane runs from the front of the plane to the back of the plane down the center of the aisle at 4 miles per hour. What is the speed and direction of the person who is running relative to the ground below? Okay? So you got like the plane, you got the wind, you got a person running, all that together, relative to the ground, what's happening? You're right. All right, now we can move on. Don't worry, everyone. It'll pick up if you're a little bit wondering if this class ever gets challenging. It'll pick up for you. I've heard that. That's a lot of people do tell me that. Cal 2 is harder than Cal 3, but I wouldn't walk into this thinking that necessarily because you don't want to be surprised. You know, you don't want to be like, wait, this is supposed to be easier. All right, now we move on to the dot product. So look, so far, the only thing we can do with a vector, if someone gives us a vector or two vectors, we can add them, right? We can subtract them. We can scale them. So I can take a vector and double it or multiply it by half or multiply it by -5. But just like everything else, we want to know what happens when you multiply two vectors together. Does it mean anything? Well, it turns out that this is different than numbers. Numbers, you multiply two numbers together, you get a number, right? Turns out with vectors, we have two different types of multiplication. We have what's known as the dot product, and we have something that's called the cross product. The dot product, when you put the two vectors and you dot them together, you wind up not getting a vector. It's weird. You know, normally you multiply 4 times 5, you get 20. Two numbers multiply to be a number. With vectors, dot products don't yield a new vector. That's what this says right here. The dot product, that's also called the scalar product. It's also called the inner product. We'll just call it dot product. Given, that's supposed to be just two vectors. Given two vectors in R2, we define a new type of product between them as follows. So we have two vectors, V and U. The dot product, and please note this symbol here, right there. No, it's not. Right there is a bolded dot. Okay, it's not your traditional just dot that you use for multiplication. It's a bolded dot. That is the dot product. And all it is what? You multiply the first two components, V1, U1, and then you add to that V2 times U2. So these two go there, these two go there. But if those are all just numbers, you multiply them together, add them up, your answer is a number. So this is the first time, I think, in math that this ever happens. Like normally, you take, like I said, two numbers, multiply them, you get a number, right? You take two functions, multiply them together, you get a function, right? But here, we take two vectors, get a number. So it's like two cats come together, they mate, and then you have a hamster. It just doesn't make sense, right? It's just not natural for what we've seen. So I say all that right here, all right? So let's find a dot product. Now, in three-dimensional, it's just all the first two components multiplied, second two, third two, and then add them up. So U dot V equals, notice I'm not going to have my angle brackets, not a vector. So what's my first one here? Negative 6, so I'm doing 2 times negative 3, then plus, what? Negative 3 times the 4, and then plus 5 times the 7. Everyone see where all those come from? Okay. So you have negative 6 minus 12 plus 35. Let's see if we can add correctly here now. -35 minus 18, we up for that today? 17? Maybe Cal 2 is easier. I'm kidding. Just wait. It's all coming. All right. So some properties of the dot product, things that we need to keep in mind. If you dot a vector with itself, if you dot it with itself, look at what that is. Like you have some vector, right? You take that same vector, dot it together with itself. Aren't you taking the first components and multiplying them together? And they're the same thing, aren't they? And then the second two together, and then the third two together. So isn't that just U1 squared plus U2 squared plus U3 squared, isn't it? And isn't the square root of that the magnitude? So if I square it, I get that, don't I? So do you see why this is this? So you dot a vector with itself, and what you get is the square of its length. The dot product is also what we call in math commutative, not commune, commutative, which means you can switch the order and it has no effect on the result. So U dot V is the same as V dot U. You also have distributive property of the dot product over addition. So if I want to distribute that U through the parentheses, I'm free to do so. I just got to remember that when I distribute, it's not multiplication, it's dot product. So dot it with V plus dot it with U. That answer should be a what? A number, right? The first dot product is a number plus another number. You should get a number. This next one is kind of weird. If you have a scalar in front of a vector and you want to dot that with another vector, you can pull the scalar out completely and dot them, or you can even move the scalar to the other vector. So the scalar just slides around wherever you want it. And then last, 0 dotted with any vector is what? Is the 0 vector or 0? The number 0. Does that make sense why that would be true? What's the 0 vector? Can anyone tell me what the 0 vector is? Depends on what space, right? But it's either 0, 0 in R2 or 0, 0, 0 in R3. If I take that and dot that with anything, V1, V2, then 0 times V1 is 0, and 0 times V2 is 0. So it's just going to be 0, right? Same thing over here. All right, so those are some properties of dot products. I'm going to leave this, I think, as an exercise for you. This is all pretty much mechanical, just by hand stuff here. That sound fair? If I were doing this problem, I'd probably do these two. I'd add those two together. I'd probably do 3 times u, figure out what those two vectors are, then I would dot them. Although the properties say that you can do a lot of different things here. So there's not one right way over the other. Just you choose a way and do it. Yes? I don't. I can work it. I don't mind. Sure. But we'll vote. You want me to work it or not? Yes? Don't be shy. Work it. All right, I'll work it quick. 3 times u. U is negative 3, 4. I'm going to dot that with v, which is the vector 2, negative 3, added to the vector w, which is 4, 0. Okay, see how I have that written? That's 3 times u dotted with, and then in parentheses, v plus w. I'm going to add v and w together. What's v and w added here? 6, negative 3, right? We're not multiplying. This isn't dot there. It's just adding components. Then over here, I'm going to distribute the scalar through negative 9, 12. Now dot. So multiply the first two together, which is negative 54. Add to that the second two multiplied together, negative 36, which is negative 90. So their dot product is negative 90. I would never ask a question like that on the test. I would probably never ask a question like that on a test. I mean, if I did, it would probably be worded just like that. This is too trivial for a test. Yeah, this is too trivial. You have to, look, I have to stress this to you because it's an important thing in this class. What you're going to see example-wise in class is going to be a lot of the bare bones of what you need. I mean, just this is the mechanical stuff behind dot product. Your homework is going to push you further, and the mini test is going to push you way out there. You're going to have to reach out for help in this class. I mean, that's the nature of the way it's supposed to be designed, is you should need help, and you should be getting help, all right? You can't be shy here and be like, oh, I can figure this all out 2 days before the test is due. You have 2 weeks on this exam for a reason. It's supposed to take time. So the problems I show in here, it's just, like I said, just getting the basics down. The hard stuff, just come to me for help. When you can't make the connection between this and the problem that I give you for a take-home test, you should just reach out to me. All right, here we go. Now, things do start to get a little interesting here. We have the dot product theorem, which is the first time we're going to make a connection between the dot product in something geometric. All right, with all this. Because right now, the dot product is just a number, right? Just some number. Blah, there it is. But what does it mean? Well, if theta is the angle between two vectors, u and v, then the following is true. U dot v is equal to what? The magnitude of u, which is its what? Length? Times, now, because there's no symbol between those, right? It's implied multiplication. How do I know that that's implied multiplication right there? It's a number, right? A number next to it another number, and I'm going to multiply. So it's implied multiplication. The length of u times the length of v times cosine of the angle between them. What the hell? Okay, let's see what that means. I'm going to get to a picture here in just a second. That means, the results of this theorem means this. Given two vectors, the angle between them must be between 0 and pi. Why? I don't have my markers. I have one here. I need a couple more, no? I'm going to have to use a good old pencil then. Just, I was hoping to connect them together so I can make them longer. But if I have two vectors, let's say in R2, two-dimensional space, then the angle between them, do y'all see the angle between them right here? It's acute, right? It's small. And then I go like this. That's 90 degrees, right? Pi over 2. And then straight across from each other is pi. What if I try and go bigger? Now the angle on the bottom is the angle between them. This angle is now between 0 and pi. So once you go past pi, you know, you now have another angle on the other side that's smaller than pi. Make sense? So we only have to worry about between 0 and pi. And that works for two-dimensional space or three-dimensional space. Doesn't matter where these vectors were. The thing about 3D is that no matter how I orient these out in three-dimensional space, right, no matter how I do it, there's always a plane cutting through them, right? A plane, a piece of paper that the vectors lie on, don't they? And the angle would be off that page, right? The angle between here. And again, if I go past pi, then I get an angle smaller than pi on the other side. Follow that? Okay. Now, consider the cosine function from pre-cal. Remember all this stuff from pre-cal with cosine? Of course you do. Of course, right? When theta is 0, cosine is 1. Right? Cosine of 0 is 1. Which does what to this formula? If the angle, so we're saying if the angle between the vectors is 0, they're both pointed exactly the same direction, aren't they? Then this formula, u dot v, becomes cosine of 0, which is 1, which is just the length of u times the length of v. So if they're pointing in the same direction, the dot product is just the product of the lengths. What if the angle between them is pi over 2? This is the first absolutely major result of what we're talking about here in this class. If you have two vectors and the angle between them is pi over 2 or 90 degrees, then the cosine of pi over 2 becomes what? What's cosine of pi over 2? 0, which makes everything 0, doesn't it? Which means your dot product is 0. This means if the dot product of two vectors is 0, we can say that the vectors are perpendicular. Got it? And then there's even this additional thing here. So, u and v, two vectors, are orthogonal. Have y'all heard orthogonal before? Orthogonal is another word for perpendicular. I will throw them both around here, but I'm more likely to say orthogonal than perpendicular. All right? Two vectors, u and v, are orthogonal if and only if their dot product is 0. So if I give you two vectors, I say, are they orthogonal? What are you going to do? Dot them. What does it need to be? 0. If it's not, they're not orthogonal. Okay? It's a major result in this class. I'll give you one example. I won't. Change my mind. Trying to move along here. Now, what if the angle is less than pi over 2? If the angle is less than pi over 2, do y'all remember what cosine is in the first quadrant, because here's 0, here's pi over 2, right? First quadrant cosine is positive, isn't it? So what you would have is the magnitude, length of a vector times the length of a vector, those are both positive, times cosine of some positive number, you know, cosine of that angle would be positive, so everything would be positive. That means that if your dot product is positive, you know that the vectors, the angle between them is less than 90, right? If the dot product is negative, that means that your angle is bigger. Do y'all see that? Because what happens between pi over 2 and pi? Cosine is negative. I'm getting some of this, I'm getting something like that, and y'all are all right with this. I think my picture on the next slide kind of helps. Yes. So look at these two vectors here. You see them? And I'm going to stick to R2 because it's easy. I have a vector down here on the bottom. I've got one up top. I've got an angle between them. Would everyone agree that the angle between those right now looks bigger than 90? So the dot product should be what? Negative. And you can see it here. Now, if I click this and drag it over here, still negative. If I pop it to here, what should happen? It should be positive. And see, the computer's actually calculating the dot product for me. Positive, positive. If I could get it right on top, what should it be? 0, right? I can't, for some reason, when I'm running that other program in the background, I can't drag these like I normally can. Let me see. That's pretty close, actually. What is the 4.7 represent? If those were pointing in the same direction right now, what does 4.7 represent? It's the product of their lengths. That's what it is. Now, let me pull one of these. Let me try and get it 90 degrees. Look, you can see it's getting closer to 0, right? I don't think I'll be able to get exactly 9. Ah, I went too far. Okay. Now, I can use unit vectors. I don't remember doing that. I wrote the code for all these, but it was so long ago, I don't remember half of the things I put in here. Okay, and if I go out here, what happens if the angle is pi? It's negative, but what does the answer represent? If your angle is negative, I mean, if your angle is pi. Okay, but what would the formula yield? It would be the length. This is what it was, right? But if the angle is pi, what's cosine pi? Negative 1, right? So it isn't that their lengths multiplied, but negative. That's what it would be. If they're the same direction, it's just their lengths multiplied, right? But if they're opposite direction, then it's their lengths multiplied negative. All right, here we go. If the magnitude of V is 7, the magnitude of U is 3, find the angle, and the angle between them is 31, find U dot V. So U dot V, we already said was magnitude U, magnitude V, cosine of the angle between them. What's the angle here? 31. I need to get up, move around a little bit. That's our formula. So what is the magnitude of U? Magnitude of U? 3. Times, right? The magnitude of V, which is 7, and then cosine 31 degrees. So you have to get your calculator out. You have to figure out what cosine 31 degrees is. And you need to make sure you're in what mode? Degree mode, because I gave the angle in degrees. That wouldn't be so bad, would it? Make sure you bring your calculators, all right? I'm sure you all own one. So 21, cosine 31. Who's got that for me? 18? That's rounding, right? Yeah. So I'll put approximately 18 because there is some rounding in that. Okay. Serious, yeah. I'll put approximately still. Squiggly equals approximately 18 because it can't be exactly 18. Okay, moving on. I give you two vectors. Are they orthogonal? Yay or nay? Nay. Why? What's V dotted with U? Well, that's 2 times 6, which is 12, plus 4 times negative 3, which is negative 12, and therefore it's 0. They're orthogonal because their dot product is 0. Back when I had that note up a second ago, I said given vectors U and V are orthogonal if and only if their dot product was 0, right? Y'all understand what the if and only if means? Those of you who've taken some math, and have y'all been told what if and only if means, the difference between that and just saying if and then? U dot V equals 0 if and only if U, V orthogonal. What this means is this. If your dot product is 0, they have to be orthogonal. And because it's if and only if, you can read it the other way. If they're orthogonal, the dot product has to be 0. It works both directions. In logic, that's not always the case. How many computer science? Any computer science majors? No? Wow, only a few? Okay. All right. What's that? Yeah, we use something different, but that's what they use in textbooks. The classic example that I have, if Texas, then U.S., if U.S., then Texas. So if you're standing in Texas, then you're in the U.S., agree? At least right now. If you're in the U.S., then that doesn't mean you're in Texas, right? So we would never write this, Texas, if and only if U.S., Texas, if and only if U.S. means Texas means you're in the U.S., U.S. means you're in Texas. So this is one way implication. This statement for orthogonality of vectors works both ways. That's why in order to check orthogonality, all we have to do is check dot product. It's a powerful condition that seems like, I just don't want it to kind of get under the radar as being like everything works both directions in math. It's not the case. Say again? Yes, exactly. Every rectangle is a square. Every square is a rectangle. So it's kind of like that. Every real number is a complex number. But not every complex number is a real number. Same, it's the same story. All right, beyond the scope here. We'll just keep going. Oh, now we're starting to get into something a little more interesting. I give you a vector U and a vector V. Well, kind of V. I don't really tell you a whole lot about V, do I? What I do tell you is this. I don't like that color. We have 2, negative 2, 6. I want to dot that with this vector A, 3A, negative 2A. And what I'm looking for is for us to find a value of A that makes these two vectors orthogonal, right? So I want their dot product to be what? 0. Find A, which makes that true. So what's my dot here? 2A, so minus 6A. Minus 12A needs to be 0. Agreed? So 16. Sorry, I was thinking about something completely different. Negative 16, A equals 0, right? Which means A is what? 0. Which means my vector V must be what? 0, 0, 0, which is the 0 vector, right? Y'all agree with that? That's kind of interesting. The only vector orthogonal to that vector is the 0 vector. Is that what we're saying? What are we saying? This is important that you understand this. I wanted to find an A that made those two vectors orthogonal, right? And my answer turned out to be, oh, well, only the 0 vector. Am I saying that only the 0 vector, like the only vector per, orthogonal to that is the 0 vector? And what am I saying then? The only vector that looks like this, where the first component, whatever the first component is, when I triple it, that's the second component. When I take negative 2 times that first component, the only vector that has that format that's orthogonal to that is the 0 vector. That's the only one that works. So it's important. I'm not saying that vector has no, there's no vector that exists anywhere that's orthogonal to that, only that that one in that format, the only one that works is 0. Do y'all see the difference between the two statements? Now, I'd like, if you have that mini exam, pull that out real quick, because you want to talk about, like, problems, differences between what's done in class and homework. Look at problem 3. Find the value or values of B, which makes these vectors, plural, orthogonal. So I give you two vectors, U and V. And I want to know what B makes it orthogonal. Isn't that pretty much like this problem right here? Except I'm using B instead of A. And my B's are on both vectors, not just one. And I bet you when you multiply that out, you're going to wind up with a fourth degree polynomial. And you have to set it equal to 0. So my question to you is going to be, how do you solve fourth degree polynomial equations? So we'll see. My warning to you would be this on take-home exams especially. When it would come to something challenging like solving a fourth degree polynomial equation, I know you can go to Wolfram Alpha. I know you can type it in. I know you can get a solution. But if you're going to use Wolfram Alpha for that, and that's the heart of this problem, you better check with me first that I would accept Wolfram Alpha doing that for you. Okay? Because what I really want to see is, can you solve a fourth degree polynomial equation without Wolfram Alpha? What have you learned? What is in your bag of tricks to solve fourth degree polynomial equations? We'll see. But talk to me. Don't ever assume that if 90% of this problem is solving, or this problem on take-home test, 90% of it is you solving a fourth degree polynomial equation, you think I'm really going to just say, okay, just plug it into Wolfram Alpha? I'm not okay with that. So you'll have to check with me. That's what you plan to do. But see, that's just like this. I mean, I'm following our notes almost exactly. I'm kidding. But it's an extension, right? Extending out the concept to slightly more difficult. All right, the next result is that if you take the formula that I just gave you, our formula was U dot V equals magnitude U, magnitude V, cosine theta. If you divide both sides by the magnitudes, the right side is just cosine theta, isn't it? And if I said solve for theta, you'd take arc cosine on both sides left and right. And that would leave you with the formula we have here. Right? So what this gives us is a way of finding the angle between two vectors. Unfortunately, what it requires is three things. You give me two vectors and I say find the angle between them, what you're going to have to do, you have to dot them, you're going to find each of their lengths, unless it's given to you, but that's what you would need. Like this problem right here. Find the angle between these two. I'll work this one through. So the angle theta should be equal to cosine inverse of u dot v over magnitude u magnitude v. Let me find u dot v first. U dot v is a number, isn't it? Negative 6 plus 28 plus 4, right? So 26. That's the dot product. Y'all follow that, or we've done that enough now, or? We also need the magnitude of u, which is the square root of, I'm looking at the sum of the square of the components of u. So 4 plus 16 plus 16 again. Square root 36, we sure about that this time? That's 6, right? And then we need the magnitude of v, which is 9 plus 49 plus 1, so root 59. Unfortunately, that doesn't break down. So we have 26 over 6 root 59. So the angle theta is cosine inverse of 26 over 6 root 59. And now you need to type that into your calculator. You got to make sure you get all your parentheses in the right place there. You could reduce that fraction if you wanted to first. Like what, 2 goes into that? 13 over 3, but make sure you know what mode you're in. Are you going to give me your answer in degrees or radians? Did I ask? I didn't specify. That means you can do either one. But you need to let me know what it is. Like if your answer is 30 degrees, you need to put a symbol 30 degrees on there. If you just write 30, it's wrong. So anyone want to venture a guess on that one? 55.65 degrees. And we have a couple of guesses on that. All right. So that means that that kind of makes me feel good because 55 degrees is less than 90. So the dot product should have been positive, right? Which it was. It was 26. So that kind of helps line up everything. That's all I wanted. Can I move on? Determine if these are orthogonal, parallel, or neither. How would I check for orthogonality? Dot product, right? It's parallel. You can already see it, can't you? But I'll do the dot real quick. U dot V, I'm just going to say, is not zero. So no, right? Not orthogonal. Okay? Not orthogonal. Parallel, what does it mean to be parallel? They have to be scalar multiples of one another. Hopefully you can see that if I take 2, negative 2, 6, and multiply it by what? Negative 2. Scale it by negative 2, I get the other vector. Therefore, they are scalar multiples of one another. They point in opposite directions, though, right? So they're parallel, but they point in opposite directions. How do I know they point in opposite directions? It was a negative 2, right? Negative 2 made it double the length and flipped it over. We saw it, I guess, right? I don't know, right? It's just noticing that the 2, you can go, the 2 became this, this 2 became this, and this 2 became that. Now, if that last one was a negative 14, no go. It's not parallel. And then your answer would have been neither. What's one way you could check for parallel pretty easily? Yeah, you divide. You could take every component on one vector and divide it by the other, all the components on the other one. What would it take to be parallel? Same ratio on all of them. So like if you take, let's say the one on the right, negative 4 divided by 2 is negative 2. 4 divided by negative 2 is 2. Negative 12 divided by 6 is negative 2. Did I say 2? 2. They all have a common ratio of negative 2. All right. The vertices, or the corner points of a triangle in three-dimensional space, are given by these three points. Determine if this is a right triangle. Similar to your homework, but we're going to attack it differently. What we have here are three points in space. And since they're in three space, I'm just going to draw three points. I'm going to just pick this one to be 1, negative 3, negative 2. Pick this one over here to be 2, 0, 4. And this one up here to be negative 6, negative 2, negative 5. Those are points, not vectors, right? Points, not vectors. Now, how could I check to see if this triangle is a right triangle? What's one way I could do it? Okay. Yeah, so last class, before today, we would have easily, we would have said, find the lengths of all the sides, right? So distance between all those, and then check using Pythagorean identity, right? That's the way we would have done it. But today, the approach is going to be this. I'm going to check each angle. So first, I'm going to do this. I'm going to try and create a vector that goes here to here. I'll call that, let me just call that V1. And then I'm going to check take another vector that goes from here to here, and I'm going to call that V2. If this is a right triangle, one of those angles has to be 90, right? So if I can figure out what V1 and V2 are, their dot product, would have to be 0 for that to be a 90-degree angle, wouldn't it? So what is V1? Tell me what V1 is here real quick. Yes. Okay, I think your question is, what if my arrow was pointed the other way here, like that? Then could we still do it? What do you think? Yes. Yeah, we're not adding, but this is a good question. Because do I have to, if I want to know if that angle right there, if this angle right here, if I want to know if that's 90 degrees, do I have to orient my V1 and V2 out from the same point? Or will it matter? Why won't it matter? Let's say that we oriented it a little different, like this. Then this vector V2 would actually, if I connected them tail to tail, it would really be like that, wouldn't it? If I took that V2, if it was pointed like that, I'd moved it tail to tail. Wouldn't that angle still be 90 between them? Like if you have 90 between them, it'll be 90 on all sides because it cuts like a T. So all the angles between them would be 90, right? Orthogonal. So it won't matter, but that's the way I chose to orient it here. All right, so what was the what was V1? It's the vector that goes from the point negative 6, negative 2, negative 5 down to the point 1, negative 3, negative 2. So what is that written as a vector? 7, negative 1, 3. How do we get that? 1 take away negative 6 is 7. Negative 3 take away negative 2, it's plus 2, so negative 1. Negative 2 take away negative 5. Take away negative 5 means add 5. I'm getting looks. I'm not quite sure what these looks are. Yes or no? How do you find a vector between two points? No, the vector connecting two points. From A to B. This would be last class. Okay, look. I'm taking this point right here and this point right here. I'm subtracting their coordinates. So I'm taking the coordinate of this one, first one, 1. I'm subtracting negative 6, right? Then the next one would be negative 3. I'm taking away negative 2. And then negative 2, I'm taking away, what, negative 5? That's what I did. Taking the coordinates, not the components, the coordinates of the point I'm going to, subtracting from it the coordinates of the point I came from. And that gives me the vector from that top one down to this bottom. So that is 7, negative 1, 3. Y'all see that now? Now what's the vector V2? 8, 2, 9. Again, 2 minus negative 6, 0 minus negative 2, 4 minus negative 5. Now dot those two, right? What's V1 dotted with V2? Well, we need it to be what? 0, let's see. 7 times 8, 56, minus 2, plus not even close, right? Not even close. So far, it's not a right triangle. But that's only one angle that I checked. Now you'd have to check the others doing the same thing. You have to create two new vectors. Goes from here to here. Or just create the vector that goes from here, dot those, and then dot those. Make sense? You might say, hey, well, the other way, I like the other way better. But this is going to be more useful to us later. All right, I think I'll stop there, and I'll just leave this as an open question. Because, oh my gosh, that really is time is up? How far do we need to go here? My God, I cannot believe how much we still have to do in this section. Yes, you do have homework. Check your email. I'll send it to what your homework's going to be. I'll send it as an email. I don't have time to write it down right now. Do your homework. I think there are problems on the back of that handout. But I didn't have anything for 10.2. I gave you a few problems for 10.2, but I didn't give you everything. So I'll send out a complete homework set. Okay. Let me